class of 1978. Born and raised in Cleveland, Ohio. Attended St. Ignatius High School, graduated in 1974. So, Ignatius High School, John Carroll University, never left Cleveland. So, welcome. Welcome to the United States. Welcome to Cleveland, Ohio. Welcome to John Carroll University. You are not on the East Coast. You're not on the West Coast. You are on the North Coast. You affectionately adopted that term. You are one of the five Great Lakes. We'll talk a little bit more about this theme of being on the North Coast, because there's a number of our speakers that were raised on the North Coast. So, fantastic evening last night. Terrific reception. Inspiring remarks by Gene Colleran, Chris Lowney, and amazing talented boys from the sisters from Lithuania. Where are they in the audience today? They're here all weekend. So, anyways, just a terrific event. My hope for you during the next 5 days with us is that you will think about the virtuous cycle that is in the Ignatius tradition, from students matriculating to alumni, from students learning and discerning the way, the truth, and their purpose, God's plan for them, to alumni serving the world by helping others, including our students, discern the way, the truth, and their purpose, God's plan for them. As Aristotle said, multiply thyself. And that is what WUJA's mission and legacy is, to multiply thyself. Speaking of seeking truth, just a little commercial for John Carroll while you're here. I'm not sure it's on your itinerary, but one of our illustrious alumni, including probably Tim Kesicki, who you'll hear from in a minute, is Tim Russer. Tim Russer from the class of 1972. We have the Tim Russer School of Communication. If you go across the quad, it's a building to your left. There's an exhibit there. For those of you who don't know Tim Russer, he was born in Buffalo, New York, also on the North Coast, on Lake Erie. That's where all the snow goes, the Buffalo. We just did a little piece of that. But Tim Russer moderated a national show on NBC, Meet the Press, for 16 years. It was a Sunday TV show that where Tim Russer was the moderator. He interviewed journalists to speak about the political issues of the day. And Tim Russer was an amazing interviewer. And that show is still very popular today. In fact, one of Tim Russell's legacy was in live TV in the year 2000. The presidential election was so close between George Bush and Al Gore, and this was before all the computer simulation of where the precinct votes were coming in. Tim Russell, in the true John Carroll nation's tradition, took out a whiteboard and on live TV during the election night had a running count of the votes by state, and Tim Russer made us all proud that night. But one of the things about Tim Russer, he found wisdom in the questions. You may not have the answers, but it's more about the questions that we ask that provokes dialogue and conversation and opens our ears to the question and the possible answers. And my hope for you in the next 5 days is that you will find wisdom in the questions you ask each other and in the dialogue that follows. So if you have time, make sure you stop by the Russell School of Communication. There's exhibits that show his legacy and some of the things that are still going on. So it is with great pleasure that I get to introduce our speaker this morning, Reverend Tim Kesicki from the class of 1984. Father Timothy Kesicki, S.J., is the president of the Jesuit Conference of Canada and the United States, headquartered in Washington, D.C. The Jesuit Conference promotes common goals and oversees international projects for the Society of Jesus. As conference president, Father Kesicki works with Jesuit provincials of the United States and Canada in implementing programs, represents the conference internationally, and serves as the religious superior of the Boston College of Theology and Ministry and the Jesuit School of Theology of Santa Clara University in Berkeley, California. Now, Boston's on the East Coast and Berkeley's on the West Coast, and Father Kesicki spends a lot of time in airplanes, a lot of time for thought and contemplation, right? So, Father also serves on the boards of the Jesuit Jesuits Service USA and America magazine. Prior to leading the Jesuit Conference, Father Kesicki served from 2008 to 2014 as the provincial of the Chicago-Detroit province of the Society of Jesus. He's a frequent contributor to CNN and MSNBC. Father Kesicki hails from Erie, Pennsylvania, also on the North Coast, where he attended local Catholic schools from earning a bachelor's degree in political science from Jack Carroll University. Father Kesicki entered the Society of Jesus at the Loyola House Jesuit Novitiate in Berkeley, Michigan in 1984. His formation as a Jesuit included philosophy studies at Loyola University in Chicago, theology studies at the Jesuit School of Theology and Studies, and educational administration at Teachers College at Columbia University in New York. Finally, from 1988 to 1991, Father Kesicki worked at the University of Detroit Jesuit High School, an academy where he taught theology, directed the service program, and served on the pastoral team. Following his 1994 ordination, Father Kesicki worked for a year at the Jesuit Refugee Service in Uganda, and then taught theology at Loyola High School in Detroit. From 2000 to 2008, Father Kesicki served as president of St. Ignatius High School in Cleveland. One quick anecdote, my personal anecdote about Father, is I went to visit Father Kesicki at St. Ignatius in his presidential office. He invited me to come down and see him. I thought he was going to ask me for money. And I went down to see him, and he had eight sophomores in his class. Father was teaching theology or a class to eight sophomores. So in addition to being president, he remained a teacher. And I believe this is power, it's more than just imagery. That's who Father is, from student to teacher. And I was just impressed that he took the time to still stay grounded in teaching the way, the truth to our students. So with great pleasure, Father Timothy Kesicki. Is working on an information technology challenge. Yes. Those with headphones are listening to a simultaneous translation, so I have given the translators my notes, and I will pay close attention to them. As Mike Merriman said, my name is Father Tim Kesicki, and I serve as the president of the Jesuit Conference. And suddenly, the world has become very small for me, because I walked on this campus when I was but a boy, 36 years ago. And now I come back, and yes, I have done all those things, but I still feel like that little boy talking to all of you today. I have chosen for the title something that we prayed about and sang, "The World is Our Home." This isn't my expression. This expression, "The World is Our Home," comes from one of Father Ignatius's first companions, Father Jerome Nadal. It has often been said that Father Ignatius and Father Polanco
wrote the Jesuit constitutions, but Father Nadal interpreted them to the world. Father Peter Hans Kolbenbach once used these words to describe Father Nadal. It is thanks to Father Nadal that the letter and spirit of the constitutions were spread among the first generations of Jesuits. Often with the help of these expressions, we are not monks. The world is our home. Working in our bedroom takes the place of singing in choir stalls. Words that express what is expected of a Jesuit today. It is important to understand this phrase, the world is our home, because as we continue to use the word global, the Jesuit understanding of global is over 500 years old. It is unique and it is distinct. In 2006, we celebrated a jubilee. It was the 450th anniversary of the births of St. Francis Xavier and Father Peter Faber, and it was the 500th anniversary of the birth of St. Ignatius Loyola. I remember asking Father Kolbenbach, whom I met at this anniversary, what we were celebrating, and he said, it's 500 years of something and 400 years of something else. I never remember which is which. At this symposium, there were two, one on the spiritual exercises, and one on the constitutions. And it made me think of a question that I'm going to ask you. How many of you have prayed with or through the spiritual exercises? Raise your hands if you prayed with or through the spiritual exercises. Many hands. How many of you have prayed with or through the Jesuit constitutions? Only a few hands. Father Schniller gave a talk at this symposium, and it was titled, From an Aesthetic Spirituality of the Exercises to the Apostolic Spirituality of the Constitutions, Laborers in the Vineyard of the Lord. For many of us who are familiar with the spiritual exercises, it highlighted why not only Jesuits, but you, our alumni, need to understand these constitutions, because what they do is they take what we pray about and bring us together so that we can work together. Let me try to look at this comparison through a few lenses. The first is audience. The audience of the spiritual exercises is the individual Christian seeking to find God's will in life. The audience of the constitutions is the Society of Jesus and the church upon whom we depend for our ministry. Let us look at imagery. There is a shift from the basic image of the aesthetic pilgrim in the spiritual exercises to the image of laborers in the vineyard of the Lord in the constitutions. Let us look at emphasis. The emphasis upon test or trial spirituality of the spiritual exercises shifts to project or mission spirituality and theology in the constitutions. Choices. Choices which look more aesthetically to the next life in the spiritual exercises have a more worldly, apostolic, and pragmatic emphasis in the Jesuit constitutions. God in the constitutions is found and served primarily in actions and in mission rather than in prayer or meditation in the spiritual exercises. Finally, ends. From an emphasis on saving one soul in the spiritual exercises to the mission of fruitful labor in the Lord's vineyard in the Jesuit constitutions. I want to look at this image this morning. Being a fruitful laborer in the Lord's vineyard. It can be said that the spiritual exercises are Ignatian, but the constitutions are Jesuit. To take the prayer, the spiritual experience, and then to bring people together to a common mission. What is a fruitful labor in the Lord's vineyard? Often when we use the word global, we like this image. It is a beautiful image, shot from space. We see the oceans, the continents, the cloud formations, and the wonder of our planet. There is a risk, though, in only seeing the world from this distance. We risk seeing everything and nothing at the same time. Recently, I met with Father Michael Charney, a Canadian Jesuit, who was appointed by Pope Francis to head the section for refugees and migrants in the Vatican Dicastery of Integral Human Development. He was addressing a group of us at the Jesuit Curia, and he cautioned us on romanticizing the view of Earth from space, highlighting his work with migrants and refugees. He noted that from this perspective, we really don't see the Earth. We see a planet that is perhaps no different from an uninhabited one. He said to us, if we want a global worldview, we must focus on the local and the marginal against the backdrop of the world, so that we might better understand the world as our home. What does any of this mean? Well, let us now look, let's go back 400 some years, and see how Ignatius wanted his first Jesuits to be fruitful laborers in the vineyard of the Lord, not looking at the globe, but the specific vineyard of the Lord. So what was the specific vineyard? Well, for Ignatius, it was Europe, primarily Italy. Remember that Ignatius and his first companions went to Venice and waited a year for passage. When it didn't work, they went to Rome. On the way to Rome, the Lord promised our founder that he would be propitious to him. So what did Rome look like for St. Ignatius? Here is an early map of Jesuit Rome, which hangs in our curia. And you can see the Jesu, letter A, the Roman College, letter B. They're not that big, and the other things that small. We're just highlighting what we have. 400 some years ago, St. Peter's was the new basilica which St. Ignatius would visit. On the lower left-hand side, though, you see a peaked building. For those of you who know Rome, you can see down from St. Peter's our curia. This is actually a screenshot from the movie Shoes of the Fisherman, for those of you who remember the Morris West novel. Ignatius didn't know the Curia. He did not go there until 1929. But just down from the Curia is a long, narrow building, Holy Spirit Hospital. It was an important place for St. Ignatius and his companions after they went to Rome. Here, they found the particular and the local, which would have This is called a foundling wheel. Foundling hospitals are places for newborn children. Only this wheel served a specific purpose. For those mothers who were either too poor to feed another newborn child, or too ashamed to have a child out of wedlock, this wheel was their only hope. They could ring the bell, the religious sisters would turn the wheel, and through that center ring on the bottom, they would lay their swaddling infant and trust the child to the care of the sisters. These wheels were created so that no mother would abandon her infant by the side of the road. Imagine the pain and desolation of a mother sending her newborn baby through this wheel. Saint Ignatius Loyola knew this pain and told his first companions to minister there, to encourage these young mothers that what they were doing was good, to fill them with some consolation so that they could see how much God loved them and cared for them. Until Ignatius's first companions could console one of these poor souls, they were not ready to sail to the corners of the earth, from the particular to the global, from the local to the international. For the world to be your home, you had to know these frontiers, these peripheries, these places where the burning needs of humanity met the apostolic witness of the gospel. And this was 500, 400 some years ago, Ignatius. How do we see the world today? What shapes our global understanding so that we might be fruitful in the vineyard of the Lord? Just a few weeks ago, Father General called his extended council together for a period called Tempo Forte, an Italian strong time. Father General did not have us bench pressing 200 pounds. We didn't lift weights, we did not run any marathons. This was a time for us to discern the future apostolic preferences of the society. I'm curious if you know any of these people. From left to right, Father Lisbeth D'Souza, Father General's assistant for India, South Asia. Father Gabriel Ignacio Rodriguez, Father General's assistant for Latin America. Father George Viteri, the president of the Jesuit Conference of South Asia. Father Claudio Powell, Father General's assistant for South America. Behind him, Father Roberto Jaramillo, the president of the Latin American Conference. In front of him, Father Xavier Jairaj, Father General's assistant for Justice and Ecology. Father General looking very casual on the roof of the Curia. Father Jose Mesa, Father General's Assistant for Secondary Education, who will be a presenter here. Father Ed Fassett, Father General's Assistant for Collaboration. I hope you recognize the man next to him, standing here. Father Vermin Duguna, Father General's another assistant for South Asia. Father Douglas Marcouille, Father General's Assistant for Canada and the United States. Father Danny Wong, Father General's Assistant for Asia Pacific. Father Juan Antonio Guerrero, Father General's Delegate for the Roman Houses. Father Tomas Colt, Father General's Assistant for Central Europe. Father Michael Garanzini, Father General's Assistant for Higher Ed. Father Joaquin Barrero, Father General's Assistant for South Europe. Father Frank Janin, Father New President of the Council of European Provincials. Behind him, Father John Dardis, the Secretary for Collaboration. Father Jose, we call him Jojo Magaja, Assistant for Formation. Father Victor Oswad, Assistant for Western Europe. Father Fratern Masawe, Assistant for Africa and Madagascar. of Antoine Caruel, the secretary of this society, the tall gentleman of priest, Father Akubongi Mege Orobator, president of the Conference of Africa and Madagascar. Finally, Father Tony Moreno, president of Asia Pacific. These 24 people form the general's extended council. They determine the future direction of the Society of Jesus, a very international group. But what Father General decided to do was have five of these members look at five windows on the world. Father Magadja, a political scientist, spoke of Asia. Father Orobator spoke about Africa. Father Alvarez, a philosopher, spoke about Europe. Father Jaramillo spoke about the Amazon. And from the United States, Father Douglas Marquille, an economist, spoke about the US. I want to give you a snapshot of what each of them said, because it's important for us to have this global perspective before we see what Ignatius teaches us today about making choices. The first presentation was on Asia by a political scientist. That number, 5,647, is the total number of Jesuits in Asia today. The vast majority, more than 4,000, are in India, Nepal, Sri Lanka, but largely India, the largest conference and provinces of Jesuits. Many, though, in Asia Pacific. And here's what the political scientist, Father Magadja, wanted us to know about Asia. He first said that urbanization is growing in Asia. This is an image of Kuala Lumpur. Seven of the projected top megacities by 2025 are in Asia. The top four being Tokyo, Mumbai, Delhi, Dhaka, Calcutta, Shanghai, and Karachi. High population density with inadequate infrastructure, the lack of affordable housing, flooding, pollution, slums, crime, and congestion can affect the poor. Youth. The majority of the world's youth lives in Asia. India has the world's highest number of 10 to 24-year-olds at 356 million. That's more than the population of the United States. Followed by China with 269 million, Indonesia with 67 million, Asia's 717 million young people, aged 15 to 24, comprise 60% of the world's youth. Youth unemployment is also high, which leads to much at-risk behavior. Three of the greatest geopolitical hotspots are in Asia: Syria in the Middle East, Taliban in Afghanistan, and North Korea. There are long-term border tensions in Kashmir with India, Pakistan, and on the South China Sea. Once again, the poor always suffer the most in these geopolitical crises. Asia has many, if not most, of the world's religions, and it continues to be a place of great plurality. With that, fundamentalism is strong in parts of Asia and comes with religious intolerance that breeds violence. Yet the Catholic Church remains a sign of hope, even though it is a minority in many parts of Asia. There are many initiatives toward interreligious dialogue, and the Church's care for the poor have made it more acceptable on the continent. The first window, from a political scientist, the general wanted us to see an image of Asia. We then looked through the window to Africa, just Africa, even though the conference is Africa and Madagascar, and there are currently 1,593 Jesuits in Africa and Madagascar. This is double what there were 50 years ago, but against over a billion people, it is a small percentage. The presenter on Africa was Father Akubongi Mege Orobator, a theologian, president of the conference. What did he want us to see? Well, first, They have a lot of young people too. There's an estimated 250 million people ages 16 to 24. This brings youth, energy, and passion. This also brings what he called the scarcity of depth, wisdom, and experience. For too many of these young people, the world outside of Africa is their most popular destination. He used this image as what he called an export culture. He's from Lagos, which is the dot on the left, and he often flies between Lagos and Nairobi, Kenya. He said, flights across Africa are very expensive. Sometimes he said it's cheaper for me to fly to Amsterdam, Paris, or Brussels to go from Lagos to Nairobi. The airline industry, even though Ethiopian and Kenyan, these fine airlines, cater more to the outside world than to their own continent. He invited us to reflect on the refugees. We're familiar with these images. And he taught us a new expression. He said, when a rat runs directly into a fire, know that it is being pursued by something hotter than fire. As we said, my first mission after ordination was with the Jesuit Refugee Service in northern Uganda. We ministered to Sudanese refugees. The refugee crisis in Africa has not abated since then. We looked at the digital revolution. The digital world is changing the continent significantly. Banking, health, education, and agriculture are all greatly enhanced by the digital world. Villages which had never seen a phone can now provide cellular service for everyone. Like most of the world, the digital device risks taking the place of human interaction and interpersonal communication. We learned that the East is becoming the preferred business partner. Chinese is now the most popular foreign language, and there is an emerging Sino-African relationship. The impact is massive, as the Chinese are building roads, rails, and much infrastructure across the continent. But if you look at the arrows, for every investment China makes in Africa, they take out that much more in natural resources, in agricultural goods. Much of this investment is to make extraction and tourism easier for the Chinese. There is great ideological polarization. We have all seen the devastating effects of Boko Haram in Nigeria and Al-Shabaab in Somalia. Terror wreaks havoc on innocent people. He quoted Pope Benedict XVI, who in Afrique Munis wrote, when we look at Africa, we see much more than its great natural richness. We see its joy of life, and above all, we see grounds for hope in Africa's rich intellectual, cultural, and religious heritage. But we cannot fail to see the fratricidal wars decimating peoples and destroying these natural and cultural resources. And once again, the church may still be small in Africa, but it is a powerful force for good. When one thinks of Pope Francis's recent visit to Nigeria, Uganda, and the Central African Republic, one cannot help but be edified. When Pope Francis visited the Central African Republic, many other states said, it's too dangerous, don't go. I saw Father Nicolas, our former general afterward, who learned from the Pope that the people surrounded the Pope. They would not let anyone hurt him. The church can be a very strong force. From the window of Africa, we went north to look at Europe. There are now 4,580 Jesuits in Europe. This is down almost 70% from 50 years ago. It's not just Jesuits who are down. It is practicing Catholics. So presenting on Europe was a Spaniard, Father Pachi Alvarez, who looked at Europe to through the window of philosophy, he began with this word, prosopon. If that's Greek to you, I will translate it. Prosopon is the Greek word for person. The concept of the person was created during the Christological and Trinitarian debates of the 3rd and 4th centuries. But the understanding of the human person is evolving in Europe in ways that affects the whole world. Many of you who studied philosophy at Jesuit schools might recognize René Descartes, Jesuit-educated philosopher, who taught us that the person was a reference for every truth. Moving ahead, Immanuel Kant saw the person as an end in himself. And evolving from this and other philosophy, there's a growing tendency in Europe to go away from the Christian tradition, which sees the person in relationship to others, to a growing individualism. He highlighted a former British Prime Minister who said, "There's no such thing as society. There are individual women and men, and there are families." What does all of this give us? Well, I think most of us have studied Dr. Freud, id, ego, superego. This is just a little humorous, doesn't really mean anything, but it invites us into some of this reflection. What are the dynamics of individualism? A personal freedom. I am free to do what I want. I become the reference for all truth. There's a weaker sense of belonging to a community. The importance of looking out for my own interests. Meritocracies, inequalities due to different capacities and effort. And he said to us, against this growing individualism, how does the individual person understand the corporal works of mercy? Feed the hungry, give drink to the thirsty, clothe the naked, and shelter the homeless when a boat of refugees reaches our shore. There are threats to the individual in Europe. We know the looming security threats to the individual person. How do we respond to these requests? How do we reconcile Pope Francis's call to welcome the stranger with the widening fear of terrorism? Europe is also a place for the religions of the world. A student at a European high school was once quoted as saying, "Of course I don't believe in God. I'm already 16 years old." While individualism is tolerant of many faiths, there is an emerging post-Christian mentality. Faith was for your grandparents. We are more enlightened now. In Europe, you see side by side the mosque and the church. Can believers work together? Or is the physical proximity of the mosque and the church the only relationship that these faiths have? How do we engage ecumenism and inter-religious dialogue? How can the world be our home when our primary focus is the individual and my own rational self-interest? From Europe, we looked at another window. We looked to Latin America. And the president of the Conference of Latin American Provincials, Father Roberto Jaramillo, presented on the Amazon because he was once superior of the Amazon. He wanted us to look at the effect of the Amazon on the ecosystem of the world, noting, as probably many of you know, that there are three main ecosystems on our planet: Amazonia, Congo, and Southeast Asia. In Southeast Asia, the rainforest is slowly disappearing. The Congolese rainforest also faces challenges. Then he brought us to the Amazon, an image attached to the encyclical Laudato Si. The Amazon is one of the lungs of the planet. What happens if we lose it? The Amazon region, he taught us, is immense. And you can see how many countries it covers, the largest being Brazil. The Amazon is a significant holder of the world's fresh water, one of the largest of non-frozen fresh waters. The Amazon contains a great percentage of the world's trees and animals, the flora and the fauna. And then he said that it is shrinking. A significant percentage of it is disappearing. He said something Pope Francis taught us when he met with us at the General Congregation. Laudato Si is not an environmental encyclical. It is a social encyclical because it addresses the lives of human people. It is a pro-life encyclical. And the image of Francis saying, do not romanticize the globe from a distance. Look closely. Our fifth window was the United States. There are currently 2,610 Jesuits in Canada and the United States. This is also down almost 70% from where we were 50 years ago. And presenting was an economist from the United States, Father Douglas Marcouille, who had been on the faculty at Boston College, as well as the UCA in El Salvador before becoming provincial. Now working with the general in Rome. And he wanted us to see the U.S. as a major financial and economic engine for the world and understand why the U.S. is the way it is. St. John Paul II used to say of the United States, when it is raining in the U.S., it is cloudy all over the world. What is the weather in the United States? Now, this is from the lens of an economist. We looked first at industry. The United States economic situation is not bad. Almost a decade of sustained growth, an unemployment rate of 4.3%. Wages are rising, yet there are regional and sectoral imbalances. Inequalities in wealth and income are increasing. Growth, on average, does not mean growth for everyone. 40% of U.S. adults have no schooling beyond high school. There are fewer and fewer jobs for these 40%. Robots are slowly replacing many who do factory jobs. This affects how people vote. Immigrants are still a significant portion of this country. 43 million are foreign born. This equals 13.4% of the population, the highest proportion in 100 years. 27% are born in Mexico, 27% are born in South or East Asia. 11 million immigrants are undocumented, and 42% of these immigrants are Catholic. The church is a significant force in the U.S., but it's not always united with a more complex history. 13% of the U.S. population, 39 million, are African American. Only 3% of them are Catholic. The legacy of slavery remains with us to this day. Recently, the Society of Jesus and Georgetown University apologized for the Jesuits' tragic shameful history with slaveholding. And indigenous and Native American communities also suffer from this tragic history. Border security and strengthening borders was a factor in recent elections. And as we learn in the papers, many subscribe to a doctrine which is traditionally known as American exceptionalism. This is not new to any presidential administration. The United States has always advanced a doctrine of American exceptionalism. But unemployment, inequality, border fears, drive an America first mentality that is stronger than it has been in the past. The European concept of the person and individualism is equally strong here. How does and will the United States relate to the rest of the world? So these were the five windows that Father General's Council looked at before we began a collective discernment on what the future apostolic priorities of the Jesuit order would be. I don't have that answer now. That is a process. But that engagement of the local and the particular is essential for the world to be our home. There are currently 16,750 Jesuits in the world. How much can 16,750 do against 11 billion people? When you look at the global network of Jesuit schools and the incredible network of Jesuit alumni, think about all that we can do. We have hundreds of schools, thousands of students, millions of alumni. How do we engage this world? I want to return to St. Ignatius Loyola, and I want to see how his spiritual exercises and how his constitutions speak to us today and help us to enter one of those or all of those five windows the very same way that those first companions stood beside the foundling wheel to bring consolation to souls so that they could go out and set the world on fire. In the spiritual exercises, St. Ignatius would bring us to the contemplation to attain divine love, Numbers 231 to 237, where St. Ignatius says, I will reflect upon myself and consider, according to all reason and justice, what I ought to offer the divine majesty, that is all I possess, and myself with it. So we have to begin with ourself in prayer. But that is not enough, which is why we need the constitutions to not only be a document used by Jesuit provincials and the general. Constitutions have to be shared by all of us. What does Ignatius teach us on how to discern and how to make choices against all of the challenges facing us today, of which we've only seen five very brief windows? Well, Ignatius teaches us in the Constitutions, the more universal the good is, the more it is divine. This is a central theme. We are an international religious order. We should choose that which serves the universal good. This does not always equate with boarding an airplane. We can do so much locally that serves a more universal good. He teaches us spiritual aid, which is given to important and public persons, ought to be regarded as more important since it is a more universal good. We educate leaders, we form leaders, we accompany leaders, and when necessary, we challenge leaders. We should engage important and public persons and not retreat from the world. He goes on to say, this holds true also of spiritual aid given to persons who are distinguished for learning and authority, why he was drawn to important cities. Ignatius says, preference ought to be shown to aid which is given to large nations such as the Indies, or to important cities or to universities. There is an old adage that says, St. Benedict loved the hilltops, St. Bernard loved the valleys, St. Francis of Assisi loved the small towns, and St. Ignatius Loyola loved the great cities. St. Ignatius Loyola studied in Paris and founded the Jesuit Order of Rome because he knew the influence these great cities could have on the world. We are very much in urban order. This is an odd expression. I don't know how they're going to translate it into French and Spanish. Similarly, in places where the enemy of our Christ, our Lord, is seen to have sown cockle. What does that mean? Well, while some may run away from places of tension and hardship, we are drawn to them. I know a Jesuit who was recently appointed bishop of a diocese in Turkey. He learned that his predecessor was murdered. And Father Nicolas said, "This is a very good mission for a Jesuit, to go and succeed someone who was murdered." We run to where there is tension. We don't run away from it. That we should always consider the greater divine honor and the greater universal good. And then he says, "In the ample vineyard of the Lord, one ought to select, other things being equal, that part of the vineyard which has greater need." Now this is where we find the word magis in the constitutions. It's a discernment which leads us away from choosing everything to choosing what is more important in the divine sight. Finally, Ignatius says, "Consideration should also be given to where greater fruit is likely to be reaped, to the means usual in the society." One of the reasons why Jesuits favored education is because schools produce great fruit. You form leaders who can change the world. We have to be discerning about producing similar. As you entered these days together, as an international body of alumni of Jesuit institutions, it is very important, just as the General Central Council engaged these world views, that you listen to each other's history, context, story, and experience. It's important, too, that we keep in mind how Ignatius and his first companions prayed and reflected, and the criterion they used for choosing ministry. Finally, let us never abandon prayer, because in the end, it is God's least society of Jesus, and that's who we serve. The end. With a final story. This was said in my introduction. My first mission after ordination was to Jesuit Refugee Service in northern Uganda. We ministered to the refugees fleeing the civil war in Sudan. It was my first time living there. I was grateful for the African Jesuits who taught me so much. I can remember them teaching me the difference between poisonous snakes and non-poisonous snakes. But whenever I saw a snake, I just screamed, "Snake!" The other way. Our mission was education. We were implementing partners of the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, and we were charged with education. And the UN Charter provides resources for primary education. But we built and staffed a refugee secondary school. And of course, the students who graduated from the refugee secondary school said, "Where is our tertiary education? Where is our higher education?" And then we found ourselves trapped. We had huge arguments and discussion over what to do next. We were sent there to mission education for repatriation, so that when the war got willing ended, a nation could go back. But by opening doors for tertiary education around the world, where we educated for the diaspora, and we didn't know what the right answer was, and we found ourselves in the midst of that. We never found the answer, but at least we knew the question. And we found ourselves engaged with the people we were sent to minister to and grow together. This is how we till the soil in the vineyard of the Lord, by placing ourselves in these situations so that we can ask these fundamental questions. That mission eventually closed because peace came to Sudan and the nation of South Sudan was formed and many went and repatriated. So there was a fruit, but now the mission has returned because of tension and violence. And so we return. That's where God calls us. That's where we're formed to be. That is when we can open the door and say with faith and certainty,